So we'll see if Nest is able to take on Zalay, who actually is bringing the Team Archon to the tournament.
Oh, yeah, right.
For him, he's able to do well. Zalay's a player that, you know, I see pop up everywhere, but I'm still kind of waiting for the big Zalay win, right?
Yeah, well, he participates in a lot of tournaments, and right. I think when you're in such a spot when it comes to skill, right, you will win eventually.
Yeah, I think it's very similar to Crane in that aspect as well, where everyone universally knows he's good, right?
Yeah.
He's a very good player. He just hasn't quite, you know, took a tournament quite yet. So I expect nothing less from Zalay. I think it's going to be a really close game. And I think it really is going to fall onto Nest to just keep calm and, like, and just play sensibly and try and go for the win.
One thing about Crane that I wanted to add is that he's one of the players that has a very important, important thing as a player in general, which is to have an opinion about your own mistakes.
Yeah.
That after the game, he rewinds the game, right, and finds the problems that he made, the plays that made it could have been made differently, and maybe switch the game around. And that's a very important value to have as a player.
Right. So, I mean, I feel like patience and just the ability to understand your own downfall is just one of those things. Not every single player has. Self-criticism is not something everybody has. That being said, we'll be going on to the game. Both players are ready. Zalay and Ness will be fighting off for that top 8 spot. Whoever loses this will be fighting off against Johnny Stone for the decider match to see which of them is going to come up on top. So Ness with the Priest, which I want to say is probably an exception in this tournament as we haven't seen too much of it. And Zalay bringing the Rogue, that is a deck he plays very well. No Warrior from either player, which we've seen a ton of in this tournament.
Yeah, Ness specifically just loves Priest. I think he would bring it in any lineup to any tournament, no matter how good Priest is deemed overall in terms of the current metagame. So he's really looking to exploit that. And, you know, being able to play when your favorite or most comfortable classes is quite important. And because this tournament doesn't have any bans, he's allowed to do that. And he's going to end up playing that deck at some point. So that's going to be good for him. But Zalay playing, you know, the Rogue, pretty much the
right.
class.
Right.
Pretty much the class everyone said that's going to do the best in this tournament overall.
Yeah, I mean, everybody who's played it so far has had very, very good results. Some people say Priest is basically a worse Warrior. We'll have to see if Ness is, at this point, going to play a style of Priest that is going to try to do and mimic what Warriors do. The first match is going to be the Rogue from Zalay versus Warlock from Ness. Looks like it could be anything, probably Reno, I want to say, based on the coil, and not Zoo. Mm-hmm. But it could also just be inching towards the mid-range Warlock.
Kinda lean towards the Rena Jackson Warlock,
right?
Just because of the Mortal Coil. But I still remember the times when Zoo was actually playing Warlock.
It's been a while, but yes, that used to be an auto include in pretty much every Warlock deck, by default.
Exactly. Yeah, the Rena Lock. If this is Rena Lock, the matchup versus Rogue is really interesting because Rogue will want to sort of put them at an awkward health total, and then threaten like the burst to finish them off with either, you know, if it's the oil variant, like oil with a big blade flurry and deal with it like that. But the issue is, like, if Rogue can't quite get there, because the Rena Lock has a lot of good ways to deal with the Rogue minions. So it's going to be really tough, and you just have to really push that balance. It's kind of like the Druid versus the Rena Lock matchup, or any form of combo-y or burst potential deck. You just need to hover them around that, maybe like 18 health or something, where they don't quite want to play Reno, but then sometimes they have to.
That's the only burst you can pull off, because Rogues can't really do 30, but they can do 18.
Yeah, they can do like mid-teens at least. Yeah.
Unless you play a Gazette and Conceal.
So I see a Shade of Naxx in Zalay's hand, which is not something you see too much of in Rogue, but it is a very good card. And I remember talking to him about this a while back, where it's basically a tempo investment. And because of the way Oil Rogue is playing, there are matchups where that tempo investment is just like you're allowed to do it without getting punished for it.
And indicates that you're playing a oil version.
Right.
Right. Because that benefits the stealth minion, benefits so much from the oil. Ignite is eliminated, by the way.
Yeah, Ignite is out, and he did so well in the Swiss round two.
Yeah, and also what's interesting about Nessie's hand is this looks like it's actually more leaning towards a handlock, potentially, as a double defender of Argus isn't something you would...
Wait. Double Defend of Argus?
Yeah.
Double Defend of Argus with, I want to say, this looks like a mid-range Warlock, or it could be some kind of combo lock being played where you play Bran with the Abusive and something like Arcane Golem in a handlock.
So maybe it's Malagos Warlock?
Yeah, there's potential. It just could not totally be cards.
That. I know.
But Malagos Warlock didn't play double defensive Argus, never, right?
It might start now. I say mid. It looks like Nest a mid range Warlock. Who knows?
Well, we'll see. I really like.
I'm excited.
I really like the Brand Bronzebeard on turn two, because most likely your opponent will not have an easy option to kill it apart from Backstep Agent.
Yeah.
Right. So you can benefit a lot from that turn two, ballsy turn two play just into a Dark Peddler, Abusive Surgeon. You get so much value out of it.
Right.
That's the thing. The trade-off is so good, isn't it? Because if it survives, then. Because he has got the follow-up of, like you said, the Peddler, you get two discovers, which is huge, as Warlock has some of the best like one-mana creatures or spells in the game, and the abusive to trade with anything that gets dropped down anyway, or even just to push for damage. I mean, you know, why not?
Yeah, early game, I mean, what I like about this is that it's forcing, what, Backstab SI, Deadly Poison Eviscerate, very awkward preparation plays from the Rogue, too early in the game for it to feel good. So I like the early brand. And the earlier you play, the less likely it is that Eviscerate was picked up.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's also true. No coin, right, for your opponent, so you also limit the options that you can have to answer this this brand.
Oh, goodness. And here we go.
Dark Bomb. Okay.
This
so
is...
this is Malagos.
I would assume it is Malagos Warlock, with a bit of a defensive twist.
Ooh, there's a PO. Other two cards are basically...
Yeah.
The Murloc was fine.
Flame Imp's okay. Maybe bad with Brand Down.
I like Blood Imp with Brand Down, actually.
Why not Shield Bearer? It's very good.
You're actually right. If I'm going to take Blood Imp, I'm going to take Shield Bearer over that.
It's basically three turns of Blood Imp, and it protects your minions better from weapons.
Yeah, no, it's better. So. It's across the board better. If the play of your opponent last turn was to play a Shade, then you have to assume Shield Bearer is going to be another roadblock they can't get past.
You think that if Dark Iron Water would have still have a permanent buff, Shield Bearer would still be playable in two?
That's an interesting question. I mean, I feel like this is the type of card that will eventually come back just because it's so annoying and cheap. Mm-hmm. But we have to wait, I think, for standard rotation to kind of make everything go away to see how valuable a one-mana card that tanks four damage is worth.
Yeah, Zelay has picked up the Eviscerate, though, and he can very easily play, just equip the Deadly Poison, Eviscerate the 2-4, and then maybe even just pass at that point. He doesn't have to use the weapon just because
he's
poison.
Yeah, I don't think so, yes.
Just want to use it to proc that Eviscerate to just clear up Bran, because the problem is next turn as well, even without our knowledge of seeing the Argus in hand, turn four is an Argus turn, especially when Brand's on the board. Plus two to two minions and giving them taunt is horrendous.
You can think about it like that. The Defender of Argus, it's a 2-3 minion that spawns two tokens.
It is insane. It's as though you spawn little gnolls with taunts. One of the things that that Eviscerate does in this spot is that it kind of takes up your entire turn, but the fact that you keep this Deadly Poison up threatens a Blade Flurry, and the opponent will not want to overextend into this until they find a way to guarantee their board lives through Nuruganeg or some kind of Death Rattle.
Yeah, and also, it takes up your whole turn's fine, because one, you've got the Shade on the board, which is great, it's just going to grow every turn, and also, there's currently, even though the 0-4's annoying, it's not threatening in any way, and there's just two power on board, so he's probably okay with that. And he does have multiple follow-ups, Fan of Knives, Sap, he has Belcher, all Lothair, whatever he's feeling, whether he wants to try and lock out some spells from the Warlock, I'd imagine we'd probably see just a Belcher first anyway on this kind of board, depending on what Ness does this turn.
Yeah, exactly what I wanted to say. That it depends what will Ness do, but I can't imagine he will not play Defender Battle.
Yeah, it's just good for Zelay that he has options, right? He has he can do pretty much whatever he wants next turn.
What I really like about the Defender Vargas here is the fact that it makes the Shade and the weapon uncomfortable in this situation, because you can't trade with the 1-5 minion with both, right? So the option is just to kill the 3-3 with your weapon, which kind of then is redundant if you want to play Blade Flurry.
Right. So you would have to basically use Blade Flurry right away, and this is a very weak board to take away, and it takes up two of your mana on turn 5, which can be a very important turn if you don't have it.
He could always kill the 3-3 and sap the 1-5 back to...
Sacrilege. I mean, this would be funny, though. I mean, I could see a world in which Steelberry goes back to hand.
Bear in mind, that was not the most serious suggestion I've ever made.
No, I love it. We need to do this now. Make it happen, Raven.
It's two. That 1-5 is so scary.
Yeah, so, I mean, Belcher, Lothar, Belcher basically means that Zelay, even if he doesn't wipe the board now, has time to find a better flurry. So just playing it slowly is probably one of the better options he's got.
Yeah, really interesting as well. Like Zilei, the way Zilei's built this rogue deck, feels very minion heavy, but maybe not in the atypical way of seeing the Violet Teachers
right.
and the Tomb Pillagers. He maybe has them in the deck, I don't know. But with two Belches and at least one Shade, it's got to be cutting something for them, right?
Yeah, that's true. Oh, this is an awkward turn. What do you want to do here? A few options. Defend of Argus is still an option. Buffing a
really, I mean, the Dark Bomb sugar. With the 2-3 will kill the first part of the Belcher. You can follow it up with Abusive to kill the Slime. But the problem is you don't get to develop the Imp Gang boss.
Yeah, he could Defender of Argus and then buff, use the Abusive onto the other Argus
right.
kill both parts of the Beltra.
I kind of like that.
Too terrible. You're a little bit weak to a fan of knives, obviously, and we can see Zilei has that because you've just ended up with one health minions on the board. Sorry, but I still think it's a pretty okay play. You're developing the board and clearing off that Belcher completely.
Yeah. What about Lotheb? Just making sure that you have a foot on the board that will not be answered right now, and then that turn six removal turn that you want to do right now maybe gives you a bit more flexibility.
The problem with Lotheb is that you leave the Shilder just to die. No?
Yeah.
And that's really not comfortable. Not comfortable thing to do right now.
All right. So he will opt to develop the Imp Gang boss as soon as possible.
Yeah, I think it was vital that he played some minions as well as dealing with something on the board at least. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. To just leave the Belcher and the Shade and say, you know, priority over to you, Rogue.
Have fun.
It's very scary. Even with the Lotheb down, there's always a threat of, you know, as we can see, these your Drakes. There's even like maybe a Tomb Pillager or a Shredder or something. There can be anything in there, so. The Lotheb wouldn't do as much when a Rogue already has a board.
Right, so I have to wonder though, like Ness hasn't had the opportunity to life tap this game, and by turn six, not a single life tap means the card advantage that you're supposed to capitalize on in most Warlock lists is just not working out for him right
but
now.
But are you taking into consideration that he had a double Dark Peddler?
Right, he had a great start, right? He did get card draw. It's all right, but it's not the best.
Yeah, it acts as like sort of half card draw, right? Because he
right.
could draw two additional cards without life tapping. So that was okay, even though they are like one mana. I say like low impact cards, but this Shield Bearer is still on the board. Mm-hmm. It's still doing work. It still needs to be dealt with.
Yeah, it's just really scary, I think, as a Warlock, when your options are all what you had in your starting hand, when you're supposed to really just get everything from your deck as soon as possible.
Yeah.
This is an interesting situation. Nothing is appealing, I would say.
I mean, if he wants to clear off that Shade, because he's gonna have to start worrying
about
it.
I think I like that.
Yeah, he's pretty much gonna have to Dart Bomb and then Abusive onto the 2-4.
Right, he's gonna have to sacrifice the Imp Gang boss to the Shade to deal with it.
The only good thing is there is he can Dart Bomb Abusive Sergeant and play his other Imp Gang boss. So you can still squeeze in a minion, and it, you know, he has the token from the Imp Gang boss first trade.
But then the second Imp Gang boss just left to, you know, die from the Azure Druid.
Yeah.
And you leave
you have the
spell
have
power on
right.
board for the roll.
I have
like
to wonder,
wish.
Though, like, this could be the turn where you pull the trigger on Lotheb just to get a board.
Yeah,
just
I
to
think
force
so as well.
Trades, right?
Yep.
Just to force trades, and then maybe reset. And from a better vantage point later on.
Well, we are not aware, but maybe he's playing Shadow Fleming's deck, right?
Yeah.
Right. Well, he will opt for the play that leaves him the one, like a 1-1 and a 2-4 Imp Gang ball.
Yeah, I think the issue there is, and the reason he's gone for this play, and I do understand it, is because the Shades swiftly grow into a health pool where a Shadow Flame won't really help that much because your minions' attack aren't high enough. It's getting to 6 and 7 health over the next couple of turns, which is going to be pretty dangerous.
But he has a PO to help with that.
That's true. That's true.
But,
yeah.
Well, you know, it's a wishful thinking if he doesn't even have
the Shadow Flame, right? Yeah. We don't know a thing. And again, like back to that life tap, still no card draw for Ness. Everything is looking very limited in terms of what he can do. Even with two card draws a turn, since it eats up two of his mana late in the game when he needs to play cards, it's really giving Zilei a crazy advantage.
Yeah. I'd be interested to see more of Ness's deck, and we would have seen that if he did lifetime orbit. Because honestly, like, nothing's particularly. All he's played so far are like hyper standard Warlock cards. Like, other than double Argus, this could be almost any Warlock deck. There's just like, you know, Lotheb, Bran, Power Overwhelming's Peddlers. Like, so we'll see what the end game is here. But I
double
think
Zilei's PTH Handlock could be it with the Abusive in there.
I think Zilei's done a really good job, though, because it's been so minion-heavy, he just provided too many threats for the Warlock to actually freely tap, because Ness hasn't drawn any AoE yet.
All All right. This is giving Zelay basically the type of board that rogues want to have at this point.
I think Ness has to play Lothev now because Zelay has just told him he has...
Wow. Okay, now we're talking.
The problem is, though, Zelay just told Ness that he has oil.
Right.
Why attack face if you've got, you know, like, if you've not got an oil? That three that puts him...
Well, you can have another deadly poison.
That's true, but would you feel the need to rush it? That's it. He's put him to 26.
Yeah, I would actually feel because you're getting high on mana. So even if you drop a five, like the most expensive minion that you will have in the rogue is basically a five drop, maybe a Dr. Boom, but that's about it, right? So in the upcoming turns, you will most likely have the mana to re-dagger and play the deadly poison as well. So I could see this as just being perceived.
I just like the Lothar because it sort of almost forces the minions to trade into it or ignore it, of course. But when you play a Lothar, there's no good way for the rogue to deal with it if they haven't already got minions on board. And this might reduce the board down a little bit, as it would need the Azure Drake and the like poke from the weapon, or the Azure Drake and the Belcher to kill it. Or he has to ignore it. And if he ignores it, then he might well have Shadow Flame. You know, like he might draw into it and be able to do something there.
I mean, he forced Zelay to have a sap for all it's worth. Unfortunately for him, Zelay did have that sap, and now Ness, missing out on the life tap from playing Lothev last turn, maybe doesn't find an additional answer to this, cannot play anything to defend himself. This almost looks good, but the game is likely over for you next turn.
It's 12, 18, 19 damage.
Yeah.
Just from the backstab and the oil. It doesn't matter where it lands, it's still lethal if you just played out the ball for him.
Yeah. Unless... You backstab your own minion as well, right?
Yes.
Why not?
Even if you don't have the Dr. Boom alive. So you can backstab just the Belcher or the Lothev, and that's about it. I wanted to rewind back to the turn when Ness played safe. This is something you talked about right in the beginning, where he played the second endgame boss
instead
of the Lothev. I think the Lothev was a better outcome in that situation because, as you said, Noxious, it was setting up a bait basically for next turn. Right, you play a better minion on board, which can benefit the Abyssal Surgeon, which can benefit from the Abyssal Surgeon or the Defensive Argus next turn, and you play around. A board clear, a Blade Flurry, Fan of Knives, or Backstab as well, right? And you just, if you play the second Imprint boss, then you're leaving the board on mercy of Zelay not having any kind of AoE.
You're hoping that he has basically nothing in his hand. So it's a bit of a gamble to take. I mean, Ness did take it in the end, and it didn't pay off. Hopefully for him, the Druid play ends up being a bit better. Rogues, again, very powerful class. We've seen it in the tournament, just doing so well. Zelay's just continue on the streak of victories with that class.
Yeah, and also, even looking at the whole lineup from Ness, like, Rogue is a problem, which is why he's avoiding Priest at the moment. Because Rogue versus Priest is definitely one of those matchups that's never really changed in the fact that Rogue can just almost just always beat it. You know, it feels like it has a really good matchup, because Priest is very slow, and then Rogue just cashes in on that. And just, like, every time, like, one minion's played, they can just sap it away. Yeah. And then Priest just can't recover very well from being behind. They need to be ahead. And, this is going to be a rough one for Ness. If he loses this game, he has to win all three with his Priest alone. So
it's not impossible.
It's not impossible.
Let's just put it that way. Priest is not played by anyone right now, and there's a decent reason for that.
Yeah.
Most people are shying away from playing the class in tournament mode. And I think Rogue and Priest have this in common, I guess, that when you play that class in a tournament setting, you've got to be a diehard fan of it. Most players
who
like Rogue will swear by it no matter what. Most players who like Priest will swear by it no matter what. And I think just in that, they kind of join.
And to be fair, you know what? I know for a fact Ness was playing Priest yesterday, and it's got him this
far.
There
we go.
He finished second. So, you know, it's not like he can't do it. I'm just saying it's very difficult in terms of matchups.
It is.
So Zelay's opening hand feels pretty decent with a Shade of Naxxramas and an SI7 agent. He gains the coin, has prep, has sprint. I mean, do you want actually anything else in this Rogue opening hand?
There's only the backstab.
Yeah, I guess a backstab.
If the Drake comes out, the Shade of Naxx plus coin, prep, oil is going to take care of the Drake and put a Shade that has very high attack already set up.
And you're not afraid of the Druid taking care of it at all.
Yeah. Exactly.
At all.
Ever.
Ever, because now one Innovate was used, so there's no chance of double Innovating double Swipe on
on your Shade.
Four.
Oh no!
That's the only way.
Yeah. It's the only way it kills
it. From the game, so...
Wild Pyromancer has come to town.
Poison Seeds. That'd be so
Explosive
good.
Sheep. I need to see that deck in action in a tournament.
Yeah, Poison Seed, Explosive Sheep.
Wow.
Oh, explosive sheet poisons seeds.
No, they, well, yeah.
Let's get the sequence incorrect.
Right. They have changed the way Death Rattles work, so now that combination is finally viable.
It's actually just a board clear no matter what.
Yeah.
So good.
So Archon Zelay, currently considering how he's going to wreck TPG Ness.
Yeah, this is really interesting, actually, because the play you said about the shade into it, it's not even all in.
Like, yeah, you know, that's the funny part.
And that's what you're saying. Like, that's what you said, Lothar. There's no way for the druid to deal with it. It's not even real. It's not like making a massive Van Cleave, overspending your resources and hoping it doesn't get silent. There's nothing he can do.
That's a very cool play, and Zelay recognizes it, but still thinks a lot about the turn, and I like that because he takes his time, to just think about it. And it might not be an obvious turn to anyone, but if you think about it, the druid has no way of dealing with that 5-2. Stealth minion, it will just grow over time.
Ness is smiling. He's like, you know what? This is absolutely ridiculous. What just happened to me? I innervated out a Drake, and prep is better than my innervate.
Yeah.
What is this?
Yeah, and especially because, I mean, turn four here. Well played.
Oh, well played, he says, with nothing to play turn four.
Oh,
wow. There we go.
That's just an insult to the injury.
Yeah.
He solved the ones if he would be playing a warrior.
The problem is, like, the turn from Zelay was great, right?
Right.
And if Ness would have, like, dropped a Shredder on turn four, it still would have been good for Zelay. Like, Zelay's in a good position. But the fact that Ness had to just hero power is horrendous. He didn't even have a wild growth or anything like that to just ramp a bit more. It was like, no, I'm just going to poke you in the face with my hero power and have to just deal with it. And there's already 10 damage on the board for Zelay.
I mean, the weapon would be used for another trade.
Yeah.
It's not really. If there would be a minion played, even a Pilot Shredder, you would still attack with the dagger and just play your own Pilot Shredder. Or maybe try to combo out the agent, if there would be some draw that you could have played. But unfortunately for Ness, there's the Pilot Shredder for Zelay on 10-4.
Oh!
And out he goes. Now, the reasoning behind this is
really
you
want
to deal with this, then you're not playing anything else.
Yes, I like that a lot. Yeah. If you play the Druid with the Claw, no biggie. I mean, it will be just dealt with.
It would just Abyss and SI-70.
Yes. There's like a lot of options. And now the swipe on 10-5 is really awkward. It just deals with the minion, but you can't do anything else.
That was a great pickup, though, honestly, that Living Roots.
Yeah.
And also, though, he's just used swipe. I imagine Azure Drake feels pretty good now. Like, straight after swipe, you still have a 2-2 on the board, and you just continue this momentum and this tempo, and the druid's gonna really, really struggle to come back.
Yeah, look at that, the backstab. Just a perfect draw for the Azure Drake on the board. Unfortunately for Zelay, that most likely would be played a low tip right now. But if Ness will go for a 10-6 Pilot Shredder and Wrath, which looks promising, right?
Well, the problem is, that looks like the good play, but I think he just has to play Lothar.
Yeah,
because he needs to stop Zelay doing things every single turn. He's done whatever he wants up to now.
Right.
I just think he has to play Lothar, because it forces some kind of trade from these minions, probably.
Right.
Whereas the Shredder and the Wrath looks okay, but then what if he just has, like, Sap and then another minion? You know, like, and you're just always going to be behind. Lothar might be the only chance he has this game to just buy himself a turn, or at least, you know, some space to actually maneuver everything else.
Let's say even if there would be a simple backstab, right?
Yeah.
Play the Pulse. It doesn't have to be Sap. Backstab with the spell power is just devastating. And unfortunately, Ness this time. There's the backstab. It was drawn last turn, and it was swinging the board so much, especially with the agent in hand.
And it's just going to continue. Oh my god, 2 health as well. So he's just going to SI7 agent, I imagine, to kill the 3-2. He could even just Fan of Knives for the draw. Why not at this point? You know, you're not going to Fan of Knives that
like
much
that.
Versus Druid.
Look at that damage he's got stacked up. There was a line of play that I would have maybe considered if I'm Ness. All that's really awkward is the Wrath hero power down the Drake, and then on turn 7, you play Shredder plus Savage Roar to kill the 2-2, and then the Rogue doesn't,
I actually like that.
Like, yeah, he doesn't have a minion, right? So then you probably are okay with your Lothebs and Ancients of Lore.
The problem just last turn was that, look, you know, like, shock, the Rogue has good removal.
Right.
And it's a reset of the previous turn, and whereas if he played Lotheb, that just wouldn't have happened. And, you know, he does go for the Ancient of Lore here to just draw some more cards, but again, it's just going to be devastating. I mean, is this potentially even lethal?
I think the, yeah that's
double,
8
double
damage
of
the weapon at 4,
yeah.
It is lethal.
Well, 15, 19 damage. Yeah, that's it.
The weapon being buffed from the oil on turn 3. Yeah. Still up.
Yeah, that oil just never got used.
Yep.
Well, that was a quickie, I would say.
I'd say that too.
So now Ness
isn't a
pickle because he is left with the priest, and the priest will never want to face a rogue.
Yeah.
Blade Fury itself is such a big threat to your board, and unless you play, let's say, a Dragon Priest that has really bulky minions.
Right, and the thing is, not only do you need Dragon Priest, but you also need the Light Bombs for those very tough turns where Drakes are up, 3/3s are up.
Yeah, I think the way this matchup, I mean, Harrison is actually going to help. But I think the way this matchup goes is the priest has to have all, like, the on curve answers, and then the rogue has to draw badly for it to be like good for the priest. You know what I mean?
Well,
it's very difficult to climb the other way if the rogue has a good opening and has like the saps.
There's another way of winning this matchup. You have the answers to the minions, right? And then you finish up the game with an Aokenai Shield Kill Command.
Yeah, and just kill them. Yeah,
and just swipe his face with the burn from the Aokenai, which is very similar to the matchup against a Handlock, an example, or some form of Warlock control, where you burst him with a surprise factor, right?
Yeah, because you just cannot play around that kind of burst against Priest. Yeah, you just don't play around it for a start. Look at the opening hands. I mean, Ness has some okay mid game that he kept the Harrison, which is reasonable, especially
against the rogue.
Especially after what happened with that oil last game. You know, keeping the Harrison is pretty okay. But no turn one play, and his turn two play, maybe he just plays Pyro just to put a minion on the board. The only problem is that can then open up things like backstab into SI for like to gain more tempo. So
it also gives the turn three deadly poison. You know, the poison pastor.
Yeah.
It gives it value where it otherwise would have none. It gives Fan of Knives value where it otherwise would have none. So you might want to wait just a little bit longer. And again, I want to know if Zalay plays two shades or just a single copy, because it's been in every single.
Yeah, I was going to say, Zalay's a god at just drawing this shade.
But it was very important for Ness to actually keep that paramount.
Yeah. Right.
He had the answer to the shade, right? And he saw the shade on turn four last game. So it was very important to not use the pyromancer on turn two, especially when you see that your opponent was daggering up on turn two and didn't attack with it.
Yeah.
If Zalay would attack with it, that means he either has a deadly poison, right, or he just plans on re-daggering without anything else.
Yeah. Right.
When he didn't attack, that says I have a 3-drop.
Whatever it is, I do have something to play on turn three.
Yes.
And also, it was important as well, the Power Word Shield there, just cycling a tiny bit for Ness, because what Priest needs to do is draw, because a lot of their answers are quite janky and require like multiple cards, you know, without Can I Soul Priest combo. Or you can just draw Release, and then draw your whole deck, and then Legendary him down.
I kind of like, I have to say, this Elise for Ness, like, the alternative was to play Deathlord. But one of the things that Deathlords kind of run into against a rogue is there's combinations of play with backstabs, deadly poisons, and SI7s that just end up killing the Deathlord very quickly in the early game, eviscerates.
And also on that turn, he plays Deathlord for what? There's no shade down, there's no minions down. Like, he's going to stop that one poke with the dagger, you know, like, it doesn't really matter. Whereas playing the Elise gets it down there quickly and puts a decent 3-5 on the board.
Play shade for what?
Wow.
Oh, God. I'm becoming Nim Snow.
I'm amazed you worked that in. I'm impressed. I'm impressed.
Oh, God. Nimsh, get out of me. So right now we see the possibility of Harrison Jones, but it's not going to do anything knowing that there's probably going to be an oil. Thing is, if you're Zalay, number one, do you have info on Ness's deck?
I don't think so.
First place. That's the first question. Second question is, when you use that flurry, are you going to use it after holding it, or will you play it right away?
No.
After equipping buffs on your weapons.
I think you use it right away. If you plan to use the Blade Fury, use it the same turn when you buff your weapon.
Right. So
because most likely the priest will have to overextend to win the game, and then you just.
And you punish them for it, yeah.
Makes sense.
This is nice, though.
This is why I would like to just play the Harrison Jones the turn when I can just gain some advantage.
Yeah.
Otherwise,
force a bad re-daggering,
I think. And you still have a really good minion on board. 5-4 is just kind of like a better Azure Drake in this situation, right?
Yeah.
So it's not a bad scenario. And
I think one of the things you can do with Harrison Jones against a Rogue, as a Priest, when you know you're not going to get that Flurry out of the way, is perhaps force the Rogue to have a preparation if he's hoping to use that Flurry. By having to re-dagger, you force him to have that extra 2 mana, which often will be met with a preparation. And if it's not there, then maybe, just maybe, Harrison Jones is able to do 20%.
Yeah. I mean, I like that previous turn from Ness because he got an attack into the Belcher. He could heal Elise up past the Belcher response as well as putting the Death Lord down, which does kill the Belcher if it attacks. So I think that was a pretty good play. I don't think it was... If the dagger had like 2 charges, maybe you play Harrison because you get 2 draws instead of 1, but I think this is okay.
Yeah, so right now it looks like the oil is going to be played preemptively and the Harrison Jones is going to get the biggest weapon of his music.
Look at,
oh my god, snap
the
play!
From this. Look at, just a bit like, oh,
I did it.
Well,
there we go.
Scratch what I said.
Yeah. But I think you're right for the most part. Just at this turn from Zalae, we didn't really comment on it too much, but it was really awkward.
Yeah, it was
One more mana gave him a clean play. And just having 2 durability on the dagger gave him a clean play, but the way it was set up forced him to just try to set up for the next turn.
Yeah, and one of the issues with Harrison is it's not like the most sappable target for Rogue.
No, and
you don't really want to go do it again. So it's going to be a little bit tough here. Is there's no good way to deal with the 2/8 at the moment either. Zalae's just got a lot of answers, but none of the right ones at the moment. And having 2 sprints in hand, he's actually a bit rough, because I think he would rather have all these like more minions that we saw, like other Belchers and you know, maybe more of the 4 drops as well.
Well, if you sprint now, then you will burn 1 card then, unless you will use a backstep or a preparation for something else. As an example, a preparation Abyssal draw would be nice to kill the Harrison Jones, but I think with a Deadly Poison and a Blade Theory in hand, you would like to just sweep the board next turn.
Ideally, yes.
With the Deadly Poison and Blittery. So we might just see Hero Power, Deadly Poison this turn, and pass.
I was thinking as well, like whether it would be sap the Death Lord, do this play, but instead of using the Deadly Poison, you play the SI and then just poke the Elise.
And try to get rid of her. Yeah, that works. Yeah.
Just because, like, you just kill a minion at least. He does have the Blade Flurry in hand, though, so doing it this way is pretty nice. Are you working out potential lethal?
5, 8, 10, 15 damage, and 2. So that's 17 damage.
17 damage, yeah. It's putting the Rogue on 8 health, so it is a very good consideration. Although you could still just play Justicar and get that.
I think Justicar is perfect.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah, that Arcanine.
It's by far the safest turn you're ever going to play it. And it has the dual benefit of, because he has a bit of burst in hand, you know, the Hero Power for 4 is obviously double the amount it would normally be in terms of damage as well. So I like Justicar now. Probably run the Elise into the 3/3 so you're not playing too much into a big sweep with Blade Flurry. So you can just kill off the 3/3, have the Justicar, Harrison, and the Death Lord still on board.
No Justicar, interesting.
He's gonna hope. Oh, so he's gonna play the other Death Lord, is that it? Oh goodness, that board is unremovable. If he plays and opts for the crazy double Death Lord play.
I don't think that I like this play.
I think it's okay because he's seen an oil.
Yeah.
Like the oil is the only thing that really punishes this. I mean, another deadly poison.
But
right?
Why would you give your opponent, like you're so far ahead, why would you give your opponent a chance to make a comeback?
Yeah, I mean, I like Justicar, don't get me wrong, but I think this play has only happened because Ness saw the oil go.
I see that, yeah. I could see that.
Because like, obviously if you did this and you've not seen any oils yet and it's this late into the game, it's like, yeah, it's just going to oil Blade Flurry and then I'm in some really, really big trouble.
Yeah.
But I think this is okay. I would have liked to see the Justicar because I really feel with that card, any card or any deck, sorry, you're playing that card in, as soon as you can get that card safely down, you just get it down because the return on the investment is huge over time.
Yeah, and right now, one of the things that I guess could have backfired is if there were a Drake with that Blade Flurry making the Deadly Poison a tiny bit more powerful. And look at that, the Blood Mage Thalnos comes out.
It's a bit of a taunt that though, isn't it?
Right.
If he had the Thalnos before that Blade Flurry, the Harrison would have died, which is probably a little bit frustrating, but hey-ho.
So 7 damage right there from the board, plus the Flash Heal if you want it. Just steals that little Blood Mage Thalnos.
And again, there's a Flurry gone, so Ness is just feeling progressively safer as the Rogue is having to use removal, but not in an optimal way and not really gaining enough for it.
Is this the Priest win against Rogue? Yep. Is this
it? Could be. I mean, he has Entomb if anything big comes out. He has Arcanine Soul Priest at flash heal hero power. He could just play Justicar if he wants to be hyper safe. You know, he has so many options. And bear in mind, all game, I think Ness has been sitting on at least 5 or 6 cards.
Right.
All game. And that is what you need to do as Priest. If he ran out of cards at any point, he would be in massive trouble here.
What is fun is that Justicar into Arcanine changes your hero power into Eviscerate.
Essentially, yeah. Yes.
So that's kind of powerful.
Yes, it seems good. Yep. And it's just the fact that now as well, because he has the flash heal, he can just kill him next turn.
Right, and the Blood Mage Thalos gives one more damage, because why not? Because why not?
Yeah.
Just a bit of extra.
I'll steal that Thalos.
Which is interesting, because when you turn healing into damage, you get the boost from the spell power.
You don't heal for more.
Yes.
I'm disappointed by that.
Yes,
I wish it was
as well.
Literally, like.
Oh my, really? Do you guys want to play like the longest games ever, where people play spell power like Holy Paladin?
I do. I demand it.
Lothar's like, yep, sure.
That's what I want.
That would be very scary.
I think it'd be fair.
It would be interesting, is the word I'm going for.
So here the prep pickup allows for really nice Phantom Knives. You know, he's got the backstab for 3 damage. You can get a Phantom Knives for total of 2, if that's ever going to change.
He still needs a second oil and the Blade Flurry. Without
Flurry
that, I don't see how he's making a comeback. And he's just dead next turn anyway, so... Is it? Wait, 3 damage?
He could live if he wipes this board, right?
If he wipes the board, but if he leaves the Phantoms on board, he's dead.
So you would have to backstab the 6-3, prep a fan of knives.
Okay, so now he plays the Belcher to save himself from the Leafle next turn.
Right. Okay, let's see it.
Oh.
Valens chosen.
So we can just...
Arcanine Valens?
No, I was thinking whether you just Valens either the 1-1 or the 2-8. And then go for an attack Holy Nova turn.
Why not Entomb the Belcher and just attack 3 damage to the face and play...
Wait.
You can even play Valens Chosen.
Still play the Valens Chosen, yeah.
Yeah, and just deal 5 damage.
Yeah, I mean, I think like almost...
Set up Sleafle for next turn without the healbox.
It's just because the Holy Nova as well like kills off the... kills off the Azure Drake.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I liked it. It's just super safe. You just clear the board.
Yep, but...
But yeah,
on the other hand,
you can just Entomb the Belcher.
You change the Valens Chosen into a spell damage. So it basically adds the same amount of damage what you'd get from the Holy Nova, but you still have Holy Nova in your hand. So you get more possible damage outcomes in the upcoming turns.
That's a huge Holy Nova.
That's probably better anyway.
I take it back. Hindsight.
Always try to like kind of set up Leafles, but this is also great.
Yeah, well, what's interesting is like there's the options, right? You know, there's a lot of different plays he could have done, but this seems, pretty. I'm going to just call it, it's impossible to come back from because we can see what's in Ness's hand.
Where's the Vanish when you need one?
Vanish.
When Mill Rogue becomes playable, tournaments will absolutely. It means everybody's playing control decks. This is when we all fall asleep.
But
this is when he draws Reno.
But the problem is, we are not having, will not have any more Deathlords and
those are gone.
Rogue in standard. So without that card,
you're gonna miss the Deathlords, Lothar.
I hope we get an alternative to it somehow. And one day, I'm hoping we do. So it looks like the double Eviscerate is coming in a bit too late to handle a board like this one. The double prep, not even found. Had to prep the sprint. So. Kind of limited.
Well, this looks
looks pretty over.
Game. Yep.
And the priest looks like it's gonna get that win versus the rogue, which is kind of crazy.
I'm happy to see this, to be honest with you.
Well, obviously, like I was gonna say, this gives Ness hope to actually take the series. Well, of course he does, because if he lost, he'd lost. But I was
thanks
meaning,
for that.
Like,
yes.
Winning a hard matchup definitely helps in terms of even just a mindset aspect, you know.
Right.
This is just a good win for him, and it might just boost him forward a little bit in there. Make him a little bit feel better about the next 2 matches.
Yeah, he's got Warlock and Druid to go through. Now, I have to wonder with Zalace playing Warlock-wise. Druid, we can expect the mid-range stuff. But Warlock, if it is Zoo, then I would assume that Ness is going to be pretty happy with the way this matchup
is going. Especially if you have the Deathlords and then Arcanine into a board clear, an example, which would be awesome. Against any form of
and also the Valens Chosen, which is sort of dips in and out of Priest now and again in terms of like common deck lists. If he plays Deathlord into Valens Chosen and it's Zoo and he doesn't draw the Owl,
And if, even like, if he does, you keep it 2-8.
So. Yeah, exactly. You
know, I'm a happy
like
guy.
No particular bad outcome, but if he doesn't draw the owl, it's like, how do I ever fight through this? It's right. Crazy.
All right, so it looks like Zalae is queuing up the Druid here as a first pick. Tries to seal the win as soon as possible.
And it's a still a okay-ish matchup for the Priest against the Druid.
Because this list is better. Yeah.
If you land a Valens Chosen, as you said, on a minion on turn 3, which would be the best one with the Deathlord on turn 2 coin, right? And it's really hard to deal with from the Druid side.
So Druid picked up the Innervate and the Aspirant, so a lot of ramp, but there's a Light Bomb for Ness. And this little 1-3 is a little bit annoying for Zalae.
Yeah, kind of interesting, actually. There was always an option that where, because you need card draw so much, that a lot of, or at least a few players don't actually just play, don't play the Cleric on that turn.
Right.
Because there's no Power Shield, there's no 2-drop, so, you know, if Wrath comes out, then yeah, you've just made the Druid use a Wrath, but you've gained no card draw from the Cleric. Like,
you've given him a turn that he otherwise wouldn't have if he had no
card. Yeah, exactly. Whereas a lot of the time, it can sometimes in certain matchups work like Acolyte, where you want to play it where you can guarantee some card draw. And because Druid's not normally a highly aggressive deck, you can normally get away with it, but I feel like this turn is going to be a Death Lord. There's no point attacking in, and then, well, I suppose he could attack in and heal and maybe draw out a hero power next turn from the Druid to finish off the Cleric, but Death Lord's just more safe.
Yeah, if he had a Circle of Healing, I think the attack and heal would have been better.
Yeah.
On the off, because if he floods the board, then you always have a good reply to it. But in the spot where the 2-3 may simply stay alive and you never have a chance to clear it up and it just snowballs out of control, then I think it's just better to play the Deathlord. Interestingly enough, too, in many cases, Zalae might have been happy to coin out the Aspirant in this matchup, but because the Cleric was there, playing it on curve as the coin player makes the turn 3 of the Priest very awkward.
Yeah. He's got trying to work out whether it's worth maybe some form of, say, but maybe you want like to swipe Savage Roar or something like that.
I think it's just Wrath swipe with the Innervate.
Yeah.
Kill the Deathlord. You still have the Cleric on board, but it's not a problem because you gain a minion from your deck, which will most likely be a 4-4 or a 5-5. There's a small chance of getting it a keeper, right? But I would like that.
Sets up a good swipe though this way, right? Because he's forcing the heal, which is going to take 2 of the Priest's mana. It kills the Aspirant. Sure, but ultimately he does get to clean up the entire board with swipe alone. And because he's got the Innervate, can also cycle the Wrath on the Pyromancer now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I was just interested whether it was not all in, but quite heavy resource. He could have just cleared the board completely and kept whatever
and
came
kept,
out of
yeah.
the Death Wars. That would have been a good option. Just not give. The second you stop the Priest drawing cards is when you're going to win that game, basically.
Yep.
But this is still fine. He still has a lot of options. He's still holding on to that Innervate. I think we just have to see a Wrath here, though, right? Swipe, sorry.
Yes, yeah. Has to. Has to be.
Another question is whether he uses the Wrath as like a cycling tool or just uses hero power or even other. Never mind.
Yep. Okay.
Now, so this is really, really annoying.
You want to innovate hero power here, right?
Yes.
Or Wrath, but I kind of like hero power instead.
I think hero power is correct because you would like to keep that Wrath to clear up the second Deathlord, an example.
3 damage is good.
Yeah, 3 damage is all.
And he doesn't need cards. He's about to, you know, he's slowly working his way towards Ancient of Lore anyway. He has such a strong board that I don't feel you need to take that extra card draw. So I like the shapeshift from Zalae over the Wrath.
It's much better. With the Drake as well.
I think a lot of people actually just value the one-hit card draw, like any opportunity they get. It's like, oh, actually, the 3 damage can be really useful.
That was kind of awkward. Entomb, 6 mana. Light Bomb, 6 mana as well. And still, the Shredder will have a drop from it, so.
And the problem as well is the Soul Priest, because he's on 5, like, he couldn't even. Obviously, it would have been 6, so it would have been fine anyway, but can't even do a hero power, so he's just got to drop a Soul Priest. Pretty much as a 3-5 at the moment.
I think he's happy to stall, though, because he's got this Light Bomb in hand, which will eventually reset the board. And Druids have, besides Druid of the Claw, most Druid cards end up, I guess, Keeper of the Grove, most of them have as much attack as they have health in the current way mid-range Druid is built, so you can get a really good Light Bomb followed by a single minion being entombed, and then your Akenai can start picking away at other targets.
This is a tough one because you kind of have to just play as if your opponent's got Light Bomb on turn 6.
Right.
So he's going to put out the Drake there just to cycle, which is probably the better option out of them all.
Yeah,
just keep the Shredder, which is good because he doesn't want whatever drops out of the Shredder being cleared up by a Light Bomb. As if it does come down, there's someone dying anyway.
No, that's unplayable. Well, you can't play the Aokanai in circle because then you give out the Aokanai to your opponent. So Light Bomb is done.
You'd have to ping it yourself, right? You'd have to play Aokanai, ping your Aokanai, and then play the circle.
Which Light Bomb gives you almost.
Now you want to give him the Aokanai. Why did you not? No, it's too late. You can't go back on your word. Somebody dies to the Light Well.
That happened once, right, during a tournament.
I remember that somebody ended up taking. It was like a
Mistress of Pain as well.
Some, like, it was a shaman, I think, that ended up stealing it back in the days, and they ended up losing their totems every turn, and it was just the most frustrating thing.
Okay, so Zalade does drop down the Ancient of Lore and goes into Lothab and another Shade. So after seeing the Light Bomb, your Shades have got to feel a little bit safer. Still open to Holy Nova, of course, but maybe you just play one at a time. And see what the follow-up there is. But Ness is in that situation as Priest where you have a lot of more reactive cards and not a lot to do with them. Entombing the Ancient of Lore is going to be nice because you can get card draw later from it. But, you know, just dropping a Zombie Chow is just like, eh.
It's okay. The thing is, like, he had the option of going Aokanai and then Velen's Chosen it to get us to 5 damage circle.
Yeah.
But ultimately, that does leave you with a 4 health minion against a Druid who's only used one swipe. No Wraths yet. So.
And the thing is as well, like, Ness is in no rush.
Right.
He's not trying to end the game quickly, he just wants to secure the board first, as Druid is notorious for not being able to clear a board of multiple minions.
Agree.
So Liz is going to have to pace himself, minion-wise. Don't overextend into a second board clear, and then...
There's still a lot of options when it comes to board clear.
Right.
Might be second Light Bomb, Aokanai Circle, Holy Nova, so you can play two Shades at the same time without some form of insurance and from, let's say, Lothab.
Yeah, let's say you go for Lothab after a decent Innervate play with double shield.
I'd really like to see Cabal onto the 0-5.
It would be great.
From Ness. Because the thing is as well, if it draws out a Silence, because it's not so, a Druid doesn't want to pile 5 damage into a 0-5, right? If it draws out a Silence, then he has Velen's Chosen on it, which then makes it a very, like, not high attack, but a very sticky minion.
And it's got spell damage, which makes that Holy Nova in the future even more dangerous.
Exactly. Now I imagine we are going to see Aokanai Circle come down as it deals with the Shade as well as getting... Okay, and the second Zombie Chow.
I think
we'll see Cabal a lot.
Cabal Shadow Priest looks way better than the Aokanai Circle this time. Like the Zombie Chows, you don't want to play Mana Blast in those situations.
You don't want 10 damage to face Lothar?
And this is the
Mind Blast!
your lone cards, your opponent has the board advantage and the card advantage, so Mana Blast in this situation, when your opponent is also higher in life, it doesn't do
as much as
anything,
you want.
Right?
So,
if you want to be logical about it, Lothar, then fine.
Thank you.
So we'll have to see if Ness is able to pick up that Ancient of Lore he entombed to get himself card draw, because that would be an amazing draw. Considering 5 health is very tough to remove. That's right, 5 damage to face. With the Zombie Chow?
Wow, he's going for the clear.
Whoa, that's an early Shade.
Oh, he didn't play the second Chow.
Well, no. You gotta have standards.
Yeah, you just do 10 to face. Assert dominance.
I mean, you do get a really big Aokanai Soul Priest in this spot, so it is tough to remove for the Druid. You know, a 5-5 is not something that's so easy to take care of. But, you know, going back to what I was talking about, there's only one swipe that's been seen, right? You haven't seen Wraths, really? You've seen one Wrath?
One.
You're missing the Keepers, so... Lots of stuff still yet to be played for the Druid player.
Yeah, on this turn from Zalae, I would just really like the Emperor. It's a tough one, because he leaves it, the Soul Priest just kills it straight up. But
that's not a problem.
But the value from having so many cards in hand, like, just the raw value from Emperor is huge here. It means the follow-up turns, he can pretty much do whatever the hell he wants.
Yeah. You're only weak to death, you're only weak to Flash Heal. And otherwise, it's going to be a trade from the Aokanai, or like a Holy Nova plus Zombie Chow.
You're also aware that the opponent can't draw a card, a single one, unless he draws the Ancient of War, because he can't use Heal when he has the Aokanai on board, so he can't get the Cleric to get the draws.
Right.
So you can just go for value for the biggest, baddest minion you have, and just play into you know, trades.
All right.
Well, that really surprises me.
Now that's a Cabal Shadow Priest feat in the first place, and it's a silence that I'm not sure was necessary. We'll see exactly how it ends up panning out, but the thing is, this type of Priest deck is going to do a lot of work with Aokanai in general. Problem is, when there's only one card in hand, can you afford playing around Flash Heal? Are you going to get blown out by that card? Because right now, you're going to get blown out completely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think with whenever your opponent's got one card in hand, you don't play around anything.
Right.
Because you just can't presume they have that one single card to, that's going to ruin your day. But yeah, I think that play was okay. It's built up a huge board. I still would have liked to have seen the Emperor from Zelay the previous turn.
The Emperor was...
Because now his turn still... Look, his turn's still not great, whereas if he'd Emperored, he could just be like, I'll just play everything if I want. You know, he could have literally done anything.
One thing that Zelay might be trying to set up is this as early as possible play that Force of Nature Roar. So by delaying one turn, what he's trying to do is get on the board as soon as he can, and Emperor Shade follows up the Shredder Keeper the best way possible as far as minion presence goes. If there's no Cabal Shadow Priest, then that Keeper of the Grove would not have been stolen. And then suddenly you end up with a semi-decent board.
Yeah, I was just thinking, because he would have still had the Shredder, right? So he could have gone like Shade, Shredder, whatever, Lothair, or whatever, have 4, 5, 7. Yeah, he's on 9, so he could have gone like Shade, Shredder, Lothair,
right.
Which would have been insane.
Lothair gets played here, so there's no Shadow or Death for cheap if it gets top decked at all. It also forces awkward trades with a 2-minion trade. If you want to get rid of this, you're going to have to top deck something. I mean, I think Zelay is still in an okay spot, though. If he picks up Wild Growth giving him anything good. Whereas most priest top decks are situational at this point.
Yeah. At this point, is there any consideration to just not kill the Lothair here?
I think so.
And start pushing damage, because he's not got a lot to work with anymore, and he needs to actually win this game at some point. And it's not like his hand's full, so he can say, "Oh, I'm just going to answer you turn after turn after turn." He needs to turn up the heat, and if Zelay had to push into a combo now to clear the board if he feels threatened, then that's like a win for the priest.
Right. The priest is in even better of a position than he was.
But I actually think that we might. Do you have to run the Lothair into the 1/3? Unless you draw a rat.
It can also be a... No, I would say that you just want to kill the 2/4, because if the second Venom's Chosen will come down, and then you can combine the Acolyte of Pain with the Keeper of the Grove to trade with a 5/5, it specifically plays around any kind of combinations of swipes and, just setups a really big board.
I mean, I think right now Zelay just smells blood. With the Judo the Claw being in hand, with the Savage Roar, Living Roots, it's pretty tricky.
It's almost certainly going to go on the Acolyte to guarantee more than one card draw, is super important for Ness now.
What does Ness find? Holy Nova. No, that's not it. Big card, though. Big card.
Big. It's a 5/5 minion.
It's the really insane draw. When you're starving for options against a druid who's got 6 cards in hand and a board, you're kind of looking for this.
I think that was the best possible outcome when it comes to 2 draws back-to-back.
It was Nova or nothing. Like, this or Nova, but I still think this is probably better over
I was just quickly trying to work out whether healing the Acolyte was actually better than drawing the 2 cards, but I actually think just the instant card draw is better.
I mean, you still force the trade with the Acolyte regardless, at least removal. All right, so the Innervate is there for the possible double combo in the very far away future. I would not be surprised to see...
Because you can play Wild Growth into draw into Emperor this turn.
Right.
Ignore the minions, just deal damage to your opponent.
Double Druid of the Claws.
You have Druid of the Claws for 4 mana, so you have a Savage Roar and both Druid of the Claws
14 damage.
Turn, right? Yeah. So that's the same outcome of damage that you usually have with the Force of Nature and Savage Roar, right?
And if you pick up, for whatever reason, another piece of damage from the top, then you're just going to stack it.
Well, also, he has the 0 mana Living Roots for extra 2 damage. So.
And you have the Shade on board, which is, for now, kind of an immovable object, so...
He's going to use the Living Roots up on the Acolyte to make sure it doesn't get healed up to cycle even more cards. I think he's going to try to get to his combo organically.
I think that Living Roots is actually quite interesting, because the minion he's put down would have killed it through a normal heal. So was he expecting like another circle or something on the Acolyte?
I don't know.
Because otherwise it would have died anyway if he traded it in. And there's not so many ways a priest can proc damage without a pyro.
Pyro is there, goodness gracious. Okay.
On itself, so.
That is unbelievable.
I'm taking it all by now.
It's like the exit
on exactly the card he was looking for here. Perfect board clear with all his mana.
This is why I didn't like the Druid of the Claw. It's just like, overextended.
Although, to be honest, if there's even just like the Force of Nature and the other Savage Roar, if they get like reduced in cost, he's played two interface, right?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. That's really unfortunate.
And I think the thing here is, this play with Ness on like one or two cards seems more reasonable because you think, oh, well, he won't have a direct answer to Emperor,
right?
Which was his worry. He's doing this to guard the Emperor from the Ancient Law. But because Ness actually got a few more card draws and cycled through, then I don't know. I just feel like the odds for having the answer anyway, I would have much preferred to just save the Druids and have that first combo in hand.
I mean, at this point, I still have to state that, yeah, I was going to say, Doctor Boom's still not been played, and there's one health on that 5-5. So Zalae can not only destroy it, draw a card with Wild Growth, but also play a really big threat. Mm-hmm. So he's still not quite out of it.
It was setting a good lethal with the three minions, Savage Roar, and Druids of the Clone in hand, right? And could have also drawn the second Savage Roar to have even more damage on that turn.
Right. I mean, look at this right now, right? Like, we're talking about just the combo alone giving 15 damage. Dr. Boom should stay alive. Double Light Bomb is the only thing that will usually get Ness out of this.
Just get Elise down, so at least he can play both the minions, you know, build up the board again. And, you know, he might just draw the monkey straight away, and then that could get a little bit crazy from there.
Oh.
A second Savage Roar. Okay. You just combo, right?
I mean, how much is there on board? We're talking 12 plus 15. There's 27 right now, so he's one off lethal, I think. Actually, with hero power, yeah, he's one off with hero power.
What about Druid the Claw and Savage Roar and hero power?
Yeah, I think that's better because...
Or double roar with Druid the Claw?
No, you have a minion on board, right?
Yeah, I think, and also I think that's good because your second combo, so like the normal combo next turn, you have more sources of aiming the damage as well, straight from hand.
Yeah.
So you can get through like a taunt or something a little bit easier as opposed to going all in on these minions.
I like that. I must say though, Ness is going to have to find some very impressive top decks to get.
Yeah, and you go all face here, right?
Yes, all face.
Yeah, I was going to say, let's just make sure everything is going face, slap him in the face with Savage Roar.
Just thinking, what are the outs for Ness? And I think it's only...
It looks like a golden monkey into crazy cards, but even then...
Deathblow?
I don't know. You still lose to the second combo.
Yeah, because the combo's some, like...
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And this is why this is the overall better play as well, just because you get the combo which can split across. Dr. Boom still alive, the Boom Bot might just finish it. Why not, yeah.
Jessicar True Heart would heal for 6, so that would be one of the... Whoa!
That still not doesn't enough. Change
still
a thing.
No. I get excited for cards that come out one turn too late. Like, if that had been there just one turn earlier, things may have been a tiny bit different. But as it stands, the combo will finish it off.
4 damage, double 4 damage for both bombs.
Ness is happy though. He's like, yeah, maybe I lived through this turn. You know, I didn't take any damage and everything's gone. But
oh,
no,
where was the wrath? But here we go, and we see, you know what? We see the power of this Rogue. A lot of people have called Rogue of doing the best in the tournament overall.
Right.
Maybe that's still contending with Shaman at the moment because we've seen some insane scores that people playing last year are standing with Shaman, but. Zalae takes it.
Yeah, and these two classes are very capable of sweeps, which is pretty much what you want to bring in this format without a ban. Last hero standing. Zalae gets the win, 2 wins with Rogue. The priest ends up taking it in, I want to say, something of an unexpected result. So if I had to bet on that last match being replayed with the priest and Rogue, I would still give the win to the Rogue.
Yeah, me as well.
Yeah, it went right for the priest, and that's what we were saying at the beginning.
Right.
It has to go well for the priest, whereas the Rogue can like actually just recover and play and still get okay cards and win because the matchup does lean that way.
Yeah. So that's basically it for the Group B results right now.